Hello and welcome. This video is about the role mapping plays as a powerful instrument to address urban challenges. First, I will talk briefly about water challenges in cities and how to realize low-carbon cities. This will help you understand how mapping can help planners and policymakers. This elevation map of the city of Rotterdam shows the areas below and above sea level. Rotterdam is my first example of how maps have been used in successful projects. In 2003, the city of Rotterdam was preparing a vision on how to deal with peak rainfall to prevent basements from flooding, but also to prevent sewage overflow. Until then, although small-scale solutions had been implemented, an overall approach was lacking. The city planners in Rotterdam prepared an entry for the Architecture Biennale 2005, for which they used the Rose Water Plan from the 1850s as an example. This plan was there to combat cholera epidemics, so the water had to be flushed from the canals. Instead of building a technocratic canal system, city architect Rose built canals in English landscape-style parks with quality housing around them. This not only provided a water solution, but also added a lot of quality of life to the city. Now, 150 years later, these are still one of the best areas in the city. To create a 21st century version of this plan, information was needed on the required water capacity, for which the city was mapped per neighborhood. However, water was not the only issue. Other issues, for example, concerning bad public space, or poor housing quality were also mapped. This was crucial to see how the water solutions for water could also solve other issues. The data and mapping made combining water solutions with social, economic and spatial issues possible. The Water City 2035 vision presented at the Architecture Biennale in 2005 was a result of interdisciplinary studies. Without political constraints, this map showed the dream of all the people who had worked on the project. A large part of this dream was adopted by politicians at the opening of the exhibition. New projects and innovations like the water squares followed. Now, many years later, the city serves as an example of how these challenges can be approached. Another solution is the Green Roofs program, which was inspired by other cities. Mapping the potentials for green roofs also made people think about solar panels on these roofs. Later on, in the European Music Project, an energy atlas was set up. Talking about energy, and looking at energy and low-carbon programs worldwide, there's always the question of how to move from a list of initial, obvious solutions towards an overall vision, and from there to a tailor-made plan. The question was it possible to apply the water approach, the aim of which was to solve water issues and at the same time improve the quality of life? Could this be done for energy as well? The challenge was how to move from building level to neighborhood level and city level, as we already knew a lot of energy potentials at building level. So, looking at the Trias Energetica, which is actually a three-step approach, is one, reduce the demand of energy, two, generate sustainable energy, and three, provide clean and efficient energy. There's one important step that has not been included here, which is energy waste flows, like heat. Retrieving waste flows at building level, for instance, when ventilating a building you lose heat, is very important because it leads to energy neutral or energy positive buildings. In the new step strategy, the first step is to reduce energy demand, the second to exchange waste flows, and the third to generate renewables. This means that step four, having official fossil energy, becomes redundant. When starting at city level with step one, reduction of energy demand, mapping is important. Energy use, reduction potentials, and quick wins can all be mapped and feed into policies. Step two, the reuse of waste flows, can also be applied to buildings with different waste flows and on different scales to exchange between buildings and between neighborhoods. In the Rotterdam Energy Approach and Planning, which is called REAP, the four steps were systematically applied on the various scales. For instance, a supermarket can provide heat to apartments because it has a lot of cooling capacity, refrigerators. Or an ice skating rink, which has a lot of heat waste because it's a giant refrigerator, can actually feed its waste heat to a swimming pool. At city level, heat from waste can be exchanged with district heating and cooling. It is crucial to map sources and demand as done in the heat maps. This approach is also adopted by the city of Amsterdam, known as LESS or simply energetic urban planning. Step 3, generate sustainable energy or renewables, can be explained based on the following projects from the SREX project, which means synergy between regional planning and exergy. In this project, 3,000 new homes are in need of 10.5 gigawatt hour electricity and 26.5 gigawatt hour of heat. The question here is, what can be attained at local level from the plot which the buildings will be built on? To show this, the so-called energy potential mapping method was developed by Andy van den Dobbelsteen at TU Delft. Energy is space, because the renewables always need energy to be produced. So it is actually very important to plan energy spatially as well. So for each renewable, the potentials that could be harvested was calculated. In this case, solar energy. Photovoltaics, 40 square meters per household, can deliver 12 gigawatt hours of electricity. Or 40 square meters of solar collectors. The energy potential is 35 gigawatt hour thermal per house for the total. The energy potential of a large wind turbine at 100 meters for the whole area is about 160 gigawatt hours electricity. And this way we can go and look each layer. For wind at 30 meters, energy from household waste, which can be burned to make heat or electricity. Heat waste from two local factories has potential of 250 gigawatt hours thermal. There's more, there's biomass from the chicken farms, biomass from maintenance of parks and gardens, which can be found everywhere, plus biomass from maintenance of the nearby woodland and nature. There's also potential in the soil for soil heat exchangers, for heat cold storage, or geothermal energy. This way we get an interesting stack of information. A lot of information was available to the urban planners, who now could plan the neighborhood in an energy-efficient way. The result was a low-carbon neighborhood with the green pioneering field. Each was now linked to a different potential, each part of the neighborhood. Some choose on-site renewables, whereas others choose, for instance, the use of chicken manure to heat their homes. The result was an almost autarkic neighborhood. When energy potential mapping is done for the entire city, one can produce an energy atlas. The city of Amsterdam and Rotterdam have published an online energy atlas. There's also an initiative to make a national energy atlas. When doing step 1, 2, and 3, actually we have the right information to conduct scenario planning. For instance, with the GRIP tool, which was developed by Sebastian Carney in 2007. It allows stakeholders to challenge the energy mix and change it so that they can see the effects which it has on the carbon intensity. This tool makes it possible to plan future low-carbon energy mixes for cities. This can result in action plans per sector. Let us look, for instance, at mobility and how this can change carbon emissions and, at the same time, improve quality of life. A green biking network provides quality of life and reduces carbon emissions, which can be calculated. Green tramways provide public transport, improve the quality of public places, and reduce heat islands at the same time. Turning parking lots into parks gives room for walking and biking, improves public spaces, and reduces again carbon emissions. The same goes for child-friendly neighborhoods. They have the same effect. Fewer cars, more walking and biking. The four-step approach is constantly backed up with data and maps. It leads to valuable information and actions. So now you understand that data mapping helped planners and policymakers with decision making. I hope these examples may serve as a source of inspiration to you.